Hello and welcome to the Lharbur Show. My name is Luke Harbur. I am your guest. I am your host. And today we have the incredible Nick Haines from KCPT. Nick, how are you doing today?
Well, I wanted to be the host. So you're making it. So I don't like to ask questions about myself. So this is a first for me.
Yes.
And you were so impressive. I was willing to do it all. And it was the homemade quiche.
Yes,
that really
the quiche at the
took
beginning.
It over the edge.
Fair enough. Well, are you ready to jump into the first segment of the show?
Alrighty.
Harbur Hot Takes.
Let's do it.
Okay, so for Harbur Hot Takes, Nick here gets three random topics and he only gets one sentence per topic for his opinion. Okay.
British people are not very economical with words, so okay. You're making it tough for me.
Okay, well, in that case, I'm excited. Here we go.
Alrighty.
So for the first topic, Nick, my question is, have you ever worked on the job while not sober?
I was one of 12 people taken on by the BBC in radio when I was growing up. And rather than getting any congratulations for that major achievement, my grandmother pinched my arm and said, mind the drink, because the only people she ever knew who were journalists drank. And I have to say, well, I've never been around too much alcohol, and I've not been drunk while working.
Okay. Very, very good. Very good.
I was a run-on sentence, but I did it.
You did it. It was very good. Okay, the number two. What is your opinion on reporting bias?
It happens. And we're all creatures of our environment. My personal view is, though, I'm not there to condone or condemn. I'm there to chronicle and understand.
Wow. Very beautifully said. Okay. And the last random topic for Harbur Hot Takes. What is your opinion about the least favorite part of your job?
I spend most of my time booking people. And it's constantly trying to get people to come in and do shows. And a lot of people don't necessarily want to do something. You get the same old people who want to be on television. And I really have to be very creative in making sure we're representative of the community we serve. That takes a lot of work.
Beautifully said. Way to go. You did the first segment.
We got the first segment done. Okay.
And now we have our second segment of the show, which is Harbur Talk. Nick and I have three topics that we're going to explore within a 9-minute period. We can talk about those topics as long as or as short as we want to. Nick, are you ready to do this?
Let's do it, Luke.
Okay. We are starting the 9-minute timer in 3, 2, 1. So the first topic that I want to talk to you about today, Nick, and it came from someone who submitted it on Instagram, is fake news. Now, why do you think someone would feel that's something taboo to talk about?
You know, something is, it's said all the time these days. Fake news, and I hear it, for instance, we had the mayor of Leawood complain to me about a show we did. It was something related to a news item in Leawood, and she says, Nick, this isn't exactly the way it was. I don't want you to be accused, you know, I don't want anybody accusing you of fake news. So what is fake news? And I think is it just things you don't agree with? And I think that's the problem today.
Yes.
We're just throwing it out there for anything that doesn't meet your own view of the world, your own worldview. I've been on panels, I have hosted them. It's a challenging area. That does not mean that there is news out there that is done, there is news that is inaccurate.
Yeah.
But fake news is really the purposeful manipulation of the news,
right,
to create some sort of result. And that doesn't mean just because the Kansas City Star didn't get a detail right, or Nick Haines at KCPT on his Week in Review program, I got something wrong, that there was the motivation,
yes,
was to be malicious. And I think that's at the heart of it. What is the motivation behind the journalism? And I think that's what people should be asking all of the time.
All of the time.
So regardless of what news outlet that you're listening to, watching, or reading, what is the motivation behind that story? And
right,
if it's about name calling, is it about tearing somebody down? Is it about embarrassing someone, or is it about helping you understand an issue better? That's what we should be looking at. And that, I hope, I try to do. It's just become a constant, and it's an easy throw from people who don't like what you're doing to complain about something.
100%.
So it's like when people say the word busy, by the way. People say the word busy all the time. Well, everybody's busy. It doesn't mean anything.
Everyone's busy.
Fake news has lost its potency because it's been thrown away so many times. Now, there is some areas, though, that are of concern. You know, we've had now stories. There was one in Florida, actually, at the newspaper, where somebody took over the identity of a reporter and then did a story using the identity of the reporter. We know today that you can manipulate images and video to create the impression that somebody said something when they did not.
Right.
Make somebody look like they were drunk by slowing it down. I saw some of Joe Biden that way, to make him look like he was not completely at full mental capacity,
right,
by manipulating the video. That is fake news. But most of the things that are being used are just things that people do not care for, and it doesn't meet their worldview.
Right. Well, it's very beautifully said, in the sense, too, that, you know, you mentioned news framing, how a story is framed and why, in order to get across a certain, you know, message. And I know that when it comes to, at least when I was at Ithaca College studying journalism, something that we dug into pretty deeply is Pew Research Center, and how on broadcast news, I mean, there's a certain percentage of it that is not factually true, but that is almost due to the issue of news being so fast.
Absolutely.
It's gone so fast, yes, now, and people want to profit off of the moment and not really respect the investigation or the narrative. And that's something that's become such a big issue, wouldn't
Absolutely.
You say?
Even at our daily newspaper, there isn't really many beats left anymore. So people are moving
right.
in and out of issues in a very fast way. They haven't been able to do their research. And so the errors do take place. And there are fewer editors than there were before. So just the mechanics of the news business has changed dramatically. So again, going back to the motivation, were they trying to purposely manipulate you to believe something else? Or was it just because of the limitations of the news gathering process that they had to rush to get that story on?
Beautifully said. Well, in that case, talking about beats and doing beats within news, something that I also want to talk to you about personally today is guns. And the reason why I want to bring up this topic is, in Kansas City, I recently read, we're one of the top, I think, 15 or 20 cities in the United States for our homicide rate. Now, for you, Nick, and someone who is constantly informing themselves, you know, about local issues, why do you think this is a taboo topic?
Because there are certain issues you deal with that you're never going to win on. Abortion would be one. Guns is another. Mm-hmm. There are, and it's amazing, you'd be surprised at how many people do carry guns. And that goes beyond the entire ideological divide that surprises me. Now, having come from Great Britain, where we didn't have guns, and even the police, by and large, don't carry guns. That was a change for me. But I used to cover the Kansas legislature, and I used to go up to Topeka every day, and the issues of guns and violence would come up all of the time. And what was interesting was that rural-urban split. And if you ever had testimony on what was happening with crime and what to do about it, you had city police officers, city police departments coming up to the legislature saying we needed to do something about guns. But by and large, sheriffs in rural areas were opposed to it. And the reason for that is, if you are out in a rural part of Kansas or a rural part of Missouri, how long is it going to take, if you have an intruder in your home or your ranch or your farm, for the police to arrive?
Right.
You're on your own.
Yeah.
You need a weapon.
That's a great point.
But we are living in a society. So some people, you cannot rely on police protection by the very nature of your geography. I think that's an important matter. And we are still dominated in Kansas and Missouri by rural legislators. So I think that's an important point. There's also a lot of rush to judgment on certain things about, is one thing going to solve an issue? And we know, for instance, that people will, even with the gun laws we have in place, do people care about those rules? They will get those guns illegally.
Right.
And so you can put up all these... So, you can have all these rules in the books. Why aren't we enforcing the ones that we already have? I get that. But if we ever touch that issue, you know, you're going to get a very polarized view. And then you'll hear what we talked about at the beginning of our program, fake news.
Yes.
If you talk about it in one way, then you get people accusing you of fake news on it. I will say, on a personal note, I have benefited from being from a country with no guns. And I was stopped by police for speeding going onto a highway entrance, very close to where we are right now doing this recording.
Uh-huh.
And the police officer on a motorcycle stopped me, and he says, "Do I detect an accent?" And I said, "Yes, I'm originally from the UK, though I'd lived here, you know, for decades." And I said, "My uncle is second in command of police where I live." And he told me, I'm just telling him it, that the moment that British police would carry guns is the day he would leave the police department. And the officer says, I don't blame him. I'm just giving you a warning. That was the first time in my entire life I got a warning instead of a ticket. My wife only gets warnings. I always get tickets. So by using that information, I was able to get myself out of a ticket. So I felt pretty darn good about that.
Now, that's interesting. Now, I will say, let's segment into our last topic. Alrighty. It was very well said. Let's talk about something you really wanted to bring up.
Yes.
Because in hearing about the accent part yes. of your story.
Yes.
Let's talk about assumptions.
Absolutely.
Now, why did you want to talk about this today?
Well, there's a lot of assumptions, you know, people have of you because you have a British accent. And some people say, I was at Firestone one day and somebody said, did KCPT hire you because of your accent or do you have... I said, I'd like to believe I have some other skills too. But
right.
with the British accent, it sort of cuts both ways, as it does with many people who are a little bit different, that... it can be a positive and it can be a negative. And I think a lot of people's assumptions, they're thinking, you know, British accent, they're thinking Downton Abbey, and they're thinking of all these shows and the kind of background that you come from.
Right.
And I come from a very working class background. One of the largest steel plant in Europe is in my hometown. It is on the beach, but on one side of the... Of the beach is the British Steel Corporation. On the other side is the British Petroleum Chemicals. And all of those fumes are coming up in the air. And it's actually got one of the worst health outcomes of any town in the United Kingdom.
Really?
Absolutely. You know, I came from a single-parent mother who... I was the first person ever to go to university. I remember even as a child, we would... my mother telling us, I was one of three boys, let's go behind... the sofa, because the bill collector was coming, we'd hide behind the sofa mm-hmm. because we didn't want them coming in taking our stuff. And I remember that. We never had a car. We lived in public housing most of my life. And that, one of the things about journalism, which we started with fake news, is that that we have a view of the challenges of journalism and the lack of diversity in journalism. And it's actually been said the biggest gap in journalism is the lack of socioeconomic diversity. That even people of color who work in journalism are people who have come from the same backgrounds, if they're African-American or Hispanic, as the people doing the hiring. There are very few people actually like me who have come from lower socioeconomic classes who go into journalism and are in those newsrooms.
Right.
And so that, I think, is an important thing. It changes your nature of the world and your empathy for people who are falling through the cracks. Mm. But that was part of my background. The other part of the background is that at the age of 40, my mother took her own life. At the age of 45, my brother took his own life. And so mental health has been a big area for me. Yeah. And that changes your assumptions too, because I have a wife here and four children. But, you know, about what you do about decision-making, I do things now. If you want to take a trip, let's do it. You don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. And so it leads to a much more short-term thinking based on that background. Mm. And so I think people really realize, you know, journalists are human beings. We try to be representative of the community
sure.
we serve. And
sure.
When I share the story, and I rarely do, this is the first time I've probably done it in a public fashion, but people always share their own stories. People who are well-known in journalism in this community will
yes.
tell you their own horror stories, their own fights with a lot of different issues. And most people have no awareness of that because you're just this person on television.
Right.
They think you're this celebrity or something of
right.
that nature
right.
when everybody is dealing with the same issues. Everybody wears a mask
yeah.
and you don't know what's happening in other people's lives.
Wow. Nick, thank you so
Absolutely.
Much for your time today. This was just spectacular.
Well, thank you for making me feel comfortable and giving me this opportunity, Luke. I think the world of you. You're a very creative man.
Oh, thank you. Are you ready to do the end slate?
Let's do it.
Okay, here we go.
Pause, play, be kind, make a difference.
We'll see you guys soon.
Oh, yes, I'm following you. Oh, yeah! Oh, yeah!
Oh, wow.
Woo!
If I could do that, I would.